Good evening, everyone. I'm so glad to be here tonight. And first, I'd like to give thanks to all our brothers and sisters who have made it possible for me to be in Brazil and Brother Morgan. And also, we give thanks for all your prayers during the time that we were working down in Brazil. It was a hard work, and especially for Brother Morgan, who could not speak Portuguese. But God has been so good with us, and it was a really blessing. And we will share with you maybe the next program that we have, or maybe on Friday, some pictures and some testimonies about Brazil, and how many Seventh-day Adventist brothers and sisters is coming out from the local churches. You can imagine. Hundreds and thousands and everywhere, people are coming out from the churches for the conferences because of the Trinity doctrine.
Really?
Yes. We were surprised. And we could not visit all these persons because, you know, Brazil is big. And it is 192 million inhabitants in Brazil. We spent a lot of time in São Paulo. In São Paulo, there is 17 million of inhabitants in São Paulo. And it is a great work going down in Brazil. But we need workers. We need pastors. We need people who can really help those people because they are coming out from the church, but they don't really know who Jesus is. Mm-hmm. And that is a big problem. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And we find this out in Brother Martin. We are visiting those people, and they need more instruction to know who Jesus is. And I had an experience when we was down there, but we will start first with a prayer. And because we start with a prayer, I would like you to open your Bible, and we will read this prayer of Apostle Paul, Ephesians chapter 3. This is a wonderful prayer. We will read this first, and then we will kneel down and have a word of prayer. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 14 to 21. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 14 to 21. And I would like to say hello to all our brothers and sisters who are listening. And also, we like to greet our brothers and sisters in Brazil. Oi, tudo bem? Que Deus te abençoe. And our people, Spanish-speaking people, also, muy buenas noches. Que el Señor te bendiga. Y for our brothers who are listening, maybe in Holland, goedenacht en God zegen u. And maybe there will be some people in Germany also who are listening, and we like also to greet them in their own language. Gute Nacht, Jesus ist Liebe. And I don't forget my own language, it is Papiamento. Buonanotte, que Dios benedicionabo sonang. And now we are going to our prayer, the prayer of Apostle Paul. For this cause I bow my knees into the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that you may be rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth, the length, and the depth and height, and to know the love of Christ which passeth knowledge, that ye might be filled with all the fullness of God. Now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. And to him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. Amen.
Amen.
Shall we kneel down for a word of prayer? Our Heavenly Father, we give thanks for Jesus Christ, your only begotten Son, that you have given us, Lord. We thank thee, Father, that you have opened our eyes to know Jesus Christ. And especially we pray, Father, tonight for all our brothers and sisters here and all those who are listening and all our brothers and sisters all over the world for your church, that you will open our eyes, that we can have a true knowledge of Jesus Christ, that is life eternal. We pray that your peace and your Holy Spirit and your angels will camp around us and rest, and that you give us the sweet peace of Jesus Christ is our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. Back in Brazil, I had an experience. One day, I and Brother Morgan was doing the commissary work reporting, and I received a letter. One sister tell me, my mother is in great problem. She was crying the whole night, and she want that we visit him. And do your best to visit her as soon as possible. And the problem of the mother was that the mother had problem with her daughter. A big problem. And the daughter told the mother that there is a snake in her house. And that this was a cobra. And the mother could not sleep the whole night. And she was crying. And we decided to go and see the mother and see what we can help them. Maybe to catch the cobra. Maybe if Brother Ron was with me, with us, maybe you know better how to take care of the cobra. And I and Morgan went down.
Any advice I would say would be, just don't pass me while we're running.
But, you know, the big problem was that it was not a real cobra, but she just wanted to heard her mother just telling her that there is a cobra in their home and just to make her afraid and just to hurt her. And we went down and we prayed with her and we looked everywhere in the house and we thought we didn't see any cobra. But the sister told me that this is no cobra. This is just the sister just wanted to hurt the mother, telling her that there is a cobra in there. And he was working on the mind. Do you remember some experience in the Bible that snakes were biting people?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
In the desert.
Number 21. Mm-hmm. And do you know that Jesus, if we open our Bible and turn to John, chapter 3, verse 14 and 15. Here is a command of Jesus. John chapter 3, verse 14 and 15. And it says, and as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. Amen. That whosoever believe in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Amen. Lifted up Jesus. If we just move a little bit more in John chapter 12, verse 32. John 12, 32, it says, and I, if I be lifted put up from the earth, will draw all men into me. Jesus have been lifted up from the earth? Oh, yes. What is the command today? What is the present truth today? In Numbers 21, it was a present truth for today? No, it was a present truth for that time of Moses when he made the brazen a snake and put it on a stake and raise it up, and everybody who looked to the snake was healed. But what is the present truth today with this verse? We have to lift it up, Jesus. And how can we lift it up, Jesus, in our life? Do you think about this? All the studies that we have been doing, perfection of the character, it have to do with lifting up who? Jesus. Amen. We have to lift it up, Jesus. And we are lifting up Jesus in this camp meeting with the perfection of the character. Do you know that character also is power? You should receive power when the Holy Spirit coming upon you. And you will be witnessing Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and into the uttermost part of the world. Something very important. We will just look a little bit anatomy and physiology, histology. We have been studying for these last months a little bit on histology, anatomy, and physiology. And you can imagine how important it is to study histology, anatomy, and physiology. The human body, the brain, and the 12 support system of the brain. And do you know there is some big problem today? The relationship of the brain, or the mind and the body, is very intimate. One affects the other. If the body has been affected, the mind will be affected. And therefore, we have, when we lifted up Jesus, Jesus will lift it up also the reform message. Jesus will help us to understand better the reform that we have to take care of it in this time. Dress reform, health reform, reform in everything. When we lifted up Jesus, he lifted up also the health program. And do you know one person also who will be lifted up when we lifted Jesus? We will do some exercise for our brain tonight. Suppose that we are, as Pastor Stump tell us last night, we are in the Supreme Court tonight. Have to be quiet. If you feel that you have to sneeze, it's better go out and sneeze and come back. Because you have to be quiet. And we're going to use our brain. We have to judge. And I will give some information, and we're going to judge. Some are judges or some lawyers. And you will tell me, I will give you some information, and then you will tell me, who is this person's character? The character, who is this? And what is her name? And when he died? Do you think that we can do that? If I give you some information about the brain of this person, what he thought, his character, and then we can judge who he is. I'm going to share this with you. This is a It says, soon shall our doubts and fears all yield to thy control. This person is speaking. Thy tender mercies shall illumine the midnight of the soul. And then it says, a general in battle does not despair of his army while the center stands firm. The wings may waver. There may be some confusion on the outskirts. Is there confusion today?
Yes.
Everywhere. But while the center holds, the battle is not lost. And he continued to say, so with the present truth, so long as the main pillars remain unshaken, it is a folly to leave the building, as if it were about to fall. We have an idea who is speaking? I will give you some more information, then you can judge better. I go a little before the others. Listen very good. I am very weak. I am sure that this is my last sickness. I am not worried at the thought of dying. I feel comforted all the time. The Lord is so near me. I am not anxious. Have you been close to people who are dying in the hospitals who are telling these words? Do you have that experience? I have been working for more than 3 years as chaplain in the Seventh-day Adventist Hospital back in Curacao. And you see the condition of people who are facing death. But look at listen to this person. I am not anxious. The preciousness of the Savior has been so plain to me. He has been a friend. He has kept me in sickness and in health. I do not worry about the work I have done. I have done the best I could. I do not think I shall be lingering longer. I do not expect much suffering. I am thankful that we have the comfort of life in time of sickness. Do not worry. I go only a little before the others. Ellen G. White.
Yes, it was 1915 she died.
Amen. 16th of July, Friday afternoon. She rests. And you know, I've been studying the last moment of Sister White and his last thoughts, and I will share this with you. And you can see this everywhere today when you travel, in Brazil, in Uruguay, in the Caribbean, everywhere, I believe, also here in the United States. Before she died, what she says, she replied that she was grateful for her pleasant surroundings, and that they had much improved in the years since she first came here. Sister White says then, I am pain. But if you study the life of Sister White, the last 144 days before she died, she didn't have all the health problems that she had before. Remember one accident that she fell and she break it from her and she was not able to continue with all. But she says here that Sister White says then, I am pained at the lightness and frivolity that has come in. She didn't feel all the pain on her body, but she said the pain that was more terrible for her is the pain of the lightness and frivolity that has come in. It seemed to be everywhere. We must seek greater solemnity as a people before we shall see the power of God manifested as it should be. This she repeated 2 or 3 times, almost word for word, and she seemed to be greatly pained over the matter. And she continued, oh, how much we need more of the Holy Spirit. There is a great work to be done, and how are we ever to accomplish it? But if we study God's word, and if we look to John 3, verse 13, 14, and 15, Jesus gave us the command, lift me up, and I will draw all men into me. And how are we going to lift Jesus up in this time? Reflecting the character of Jesus, his image. And this is the way how we can lift it up Jesus in our life. We don't have to look to the character of our brothers and sisters, but we have to lift Jesus up in our character.
Amen.
And how we can do this? Following the principles that God has given us, and as we look to the health message, 10 simple principles. Most of us are familiar with the word new start. That means nutrition, exercise, water, the 8 laws, but there are 10 if you really study all these principles. The 2 others are correct posture and proper dress. There are 10. And all the investigations that they are doing now, science are doing a lot of investigation about health. But my brothers and sisters, if we put in practice these 10 principles that God has given Sister White, it will enhance our emotional intelligence. Because the big problem that we have today is stress and depression. And the enemy is working very hard on stress and depression so that our body and our mind will be not in the condition to lift Jesus up. And we will talk more on the mind, the brain, tomorrow night. And we will give some more information about how we can enhance our brain, our mind, and so that we can lift Jesus up in our life. Amen. We have to lift Jesus way up. As we wake up every morning, the counsel is to stretch. Try to reach the ceiling every day. Stretch. So in our life, we have to lift Jesus up.
Amen.
And he will draw all men into him. We don't have to lift Elvis, we have to lift Morgan, we don't have to lift Pastor Tom or Pastor David, Sister Ann. We have to lift up Jesus in our life, and he will draw all men into him. May God bless us tonight, and tomorrow we will continue lifting up Jesus. So good evening.
Good evening.
I'm glad to see all my brothers and sisters here in the United States. Thank you that I have the privilege to be here in the United States. And thank you for the hospitality. And thank you for the good food that I'm enjoying during this week. And I brought greetings from Curaçao, from Brazil, South America, Uruguay, where we have been working the last few months. I and Brother Morgan is working down in Brazil, and we had a lot of good experience down in Brazil. And tonight I'd like to continue speaking a little bit more on the mind. I had the privilege in 1991 and 1992 to study in Loma Linda University when Dr. Charles Thomas, Dr. Dale, and Professor Robert were still preparing young people to do the medical missionary work in the world. And I was glad that I could be there to study preventive healthcare, and that helped me a lot in the medical missionary work. And I'm going to share a little bit more tonight about the mind. But if we study scientifically the mind, we will see that this apostle have given us a lot of good counsels. If we turn in our Bible in the book of Romans, chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. Who today like to renew their mind? Everybody. And Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2, it says, and also we have been learned to sing these verses. Mm-hmm. You remember how to sing these verses? I beseech you, therefore. I beseech you, therefore, by the mercy of God, that ye present your body as a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. and be conformed to this world, but be transforming by renewing of your mind, that you prove what is that good, acceptable and perfect will of God. Amen. Very good. Amen. Amen. In the book of Ephesians, the same apostle Paul, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 23. Ephesians 4, verse 23. And we can read also verse 22. It says that you put off concerning the former conversation, the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lust, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind.
Amen.
And so why counselors, you know, in education, it is very important that the students study histology, anatomy, and physiology. And when we study this, we will understand more this wonderful human machine. When we see all the organs, when we go deep and study all the cells, we study the chemistry, we start from chemistry, go into cell, and then go into tissues, and tissues form organs, and then a group of organs form a system, and we will understand this wonderful human machine that is the human body. But one of the most important organs is the brain. And I studied the brain. I started studying the brain in 1989. And still I'm studying the brain, how it functions, and how it works. Pardon?
We'll be studying it in heaven.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. And I'm going to just share with you some quotation, and therefore it is very important that every Seventh-day Adventist study the book Ministry of Healing. That is a wonderful book. Amen. Wonderful book. And I'm going to share tonight Ministry of Healing, page 241. Listen very good. The relationship that exists between the mind and the body is very intimate. When one is affected, the other sympathizes. The condition of the mind affects the health to a far greater degree than many realize. Many of the diseases from which men suffer are the result of mental depression. Do you know how many people on this earth today are suffering of mental depression?
A lot.
I have been working in Europe, in Germany, in Holland, and in Belgium. You can imagine how many people are suffering of depression. In Belgium, it is worse. In Belgium, every year they have a lot of problem because people who are depressed just jump before the trains and they kill themselves. And then they have a lot of problem helping also the drivers of the train because of that experience. And this happened in almost every week. And Ministry of Healing, it continued to say, many of these diseases from which men suffer are the result of mental depression. Don't forget this. Grief, anxiety, discontent, remorse, guilt, distrust, all tend to break down the life forces and to invite decay and death. Disease is sometimes produced and is often greatly aggravated by the imaginations. Many are lifelong invalids who might be well if they only thought so.
That's right.
Many imagine that every slight exposure will cause illness, and the evil effect is produced because it is expected. Many die from disease, the cause of which is wholly imaginary. Can you imagine that? And then, ministry of healing continue. Courage, hope, faith, sympathy, love, promote health and prolong life. A contented mind, a cheerful spirit is health to the body and strength to the soul. A merry, rejoicing heart doeth good like a medicine. Proverbs 17, verse 22. Are you accustomed to smile? Do you know that every smile will be noticed in heaven? We use more muscles of our face when we smile than when we are angry.
Are you sure? Do we use more to frown or more to smile?
More to frown.
I think it's more to frown.
Do you know what, when you laugh, you make exercise with your muscles, most of the muscles of your face.
Okay.
And I will continue, and you will understand what I'm saying. when we go in.
We've just been taught the other way.
Yeah, when we go into sympathetic nerves and parasympathetic nerves, and then you will understand what is contraction and dilation. And then you will see the problem when you're angry and when you laugh. But I hope that we have time to go into that. I will go directly in that. But Pastor Paul also gave us some very important information. It says, finally, brethren, whatsoever thing are true, whatsoever thing are honest, whatsoever thing are just, whatsoever thing are pure, whatsoever thing are lovely, whatsoever thing are of good report, if there be any virtue, and if there be any praise, think on these things. Philippians 4, verse 8. If the mind is free and happy from a conscious of right doing and a sense of satisfaction in causing happiness to others, it creates a cheerfulness that will react upon the whole system, causing a freer circulation of the blood and a toning up the entire body. The blessing of God is in healing power, and those who are abundant in benefiting others will realize that wondrous blessing in both heart and life. This is from My Life Today, page 150. And in the book of First Thessalonica 5:18, Apostle Paul again says, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you.
Amen.
I continue with some more quotation of Christ's Object Lessons, page 330. It says, the life of Christ was an ever-widening, shoreless influence, an influence that bound him to God and to the whole human family. It says, through Christ, God has invested man with an influence that makes it impossible for him to live for himself. Individually, we are connected with our fellow man, a part of God's great whole, and we stand under mutual obligations. No man can be independent of his fellow man, for the well-being of each affects all other. It is God's purpose that each shall feel himself necessary to others' welfare and seek to promote their happiness. Every soul is surrounded by an atmosphere of its own. An atmosphere, it may be charged with the life-giving power of faith, courage, hope, and sweet with the fragrance of love. Or it may be heavy and chilled with the gloom of discontent and selfishness. Or poisonous with the deadly thing of cherished sin. By the atmosphere surrounding us, every person with whom we come in contact is consciously or unconsciously affected. Do you know that? This is a responsibility for which we can not free ourselves. Our words, our acts, our dress, our deportment, even the expression of the countenance has an influence. You know, therefore, Pastor Allen was telling us, you know, to dress properly because that makes impression. Open the impression thus made, there hang results for good or evil which no man can measure. Every impulse thus imparted is seed sown which will produce its harvest. It is a link in the long chain of human events. Extending, we know, nowhere. If by our example we aid others in the development of good principles, we give them power to do good. In their turn, they exert the same influence upon others, and they upon still others. Thus, by our unconscious influence, thousands may be blessed. Throw a pebble into the lake. What will happen? And a wave is formed, and another, and as they increase, the circle widens until it reaches the very shore. So with our influence, beyond our knowledge or control, it tells upon others in blessing or in cursing. Character is power. Character, perfection. Character is power. The silent witness of a true, unselfish, godly life carries almost irresistible influence. By revealing in our own life the character of Christ, we cooperate with him in the work of saving souls. It is only by revealing in our life his character that we can cooperate with him. And the wider the sphere of our influence, the more good we may do. When those who profess to serve God follow Christ's example, practicing the principles of the law in their daily life, when every act bears witness that they love God supremely and their neighbor as themselves, then will the church have power to move the world. Amen. Is that beautiful? Yes. Character perfection. Can we do something to help ourselves shining, help ourselves reveal the character of Jesus? It is Jesus in us. It is when Jesus lives in us that we can reveal his character.
Amen.
By ourselves we can do this. Nothing we can do without Jesus.
That's right.
And this don't have to discourage us, but just help us to be sure that we know Jesus. In education, two very important points in education. We need an environment and we need a pattern. Are you agree with me? Atmosphere and a pattern. And who is the pattern? Jesus Christ. And it is only when we have Jesus Christ, the true Jesus, because today there is a lot of theories and teachings going around about Jesus, but if we study, most people today don't know who Jesus is. And that means that it is impossible for you to form perfect character of Jesus if you have a wrong pattern.
That's right.
You understand it? And therefore, it is very important that we are sure that we know who Jesus is, what Jesus is. Otherwise, we will never reflect or never we can reach perfection of character. And this is the big problem in our world today. And it was in Jesus' time also. In John chapter 8, Jesus talked with the Jews. And if we study that chapter carefully and prayer, we will see that the people didn't know Jesus, that the Jews didn't know Jesus. And if we go into Matthew chapter 16, when Jesus asked Peter, who they say that the Son of Man is? Some says, John the Baptist, or Jeremiah. And then Jesus come more closer to the disciple, who you say? But my question, Peter confessed that, but did Peter have at that time the conviction that Christ was the Son of God? Just meditate on this question and we will answer that on Sabbath. But the very important thing it is that we have to be sure that we know Jesus so that we can contemplate Jesus, the true Jesus, and that we can have the renewing of our mind. That everything has to do with our mind. Amen. The thing that we contemplate, we will be transformed. Then we have to be sure that we have the true Jesus, that when we contemplate him, we will be transformed to the character of Jesus Christ. May God bless us as we study his word. Amen. Amen.
So, okay.
Technical difficulties.
Okay, thank you. So,
and we, as we promised yesterday that tonight we will share about Brazil, the experience that we have down there with Brazil, I and Brother Morgan. And Brother Morgan is going to speak more and give some more information tonight. And I'd like to share with you that you guys are good students in the anatomy and physiology class that we have last night. What was the test that we have last night? Who can tell? And what part of the brain have been tested?
The frontal lobe.
The frontal lobe. Yes, and Pastor Allen was the first one that starts smiling and says that we always hear that it is, you use more muscles of your brain, of your face, to be angry than when you smile. And that is true. What part of your brain was functioning in a proper way? That we can assess as we go into the frequencies of the brain, the beta wave was functioning, and that is the frontal lobe. And that means that here in West Virginia, in this camp meeting, we are not practicing any type of hypnosis. Because if someone stand here and practice hypnosis, then you will, information will go in, but there is no beta wave frequency.
Alpha
is there, then you are passive. And tomorrow I will continue, give you some more information and motivate a little bit more on the answer, that you use more muscles when you are angry than you when you laugh. And it have to do with tension, stress. And that have to do with the carbon dioxide in the body, and I will share the problems that you will have in your body. But we will tonight share with you a little bit more about Brazil.
Amen. This first slide was on our way for our first trip. And Brother Elvis, this is when I first arrived to Brazil, and Brother Elvis was leading out because he could speak Spanish. He was learning Portuguese, and you know, the Portuguese was coming to him, and he's obviously doing well with that. But we were ministering to these policemen who were at the bus station, and they were having some health problems. And these health problems were generally due to diet. And it was interesting because they were eating eggs. And I think they were eating, he was eating 6 eggs a day. And he was going through some serious problems with his body, and he didn't understand why. And so Brother Elvis was able to share with them the cause and effect, which we learned about earlier. And the next slide, Brother Elvis had mentioned last night about the woman that was told that she had a cobra in her house and a poisonous snake by her daughter. Her daughter is not spiritually minded, and so she called Zalia, the woman sitting next to Brother Elvis, and we made an appointment to go over to her house, and that's the woman right, oh, it doesn't work, but sitting right across. So it was a good experience. And again, I still was just learning Portuguese, and I'll share a little testimony as we go, because I was there for 5.5 months, and Brother Elvis was there leading out and sharing, but he was also teaching, and I had a few other teachers teaching me Portuguese as we were going along. And this book is called Passos para Cristo, which is Steps to Christ in Portuguese. And we picked up these books, a few cases, a few hundred of them, and we were going to Lorena, where we were going to distribute the books, sell the books, as well as distribute them at Aparecida. Now, Aparecida is a festival of, it's like a Mary. They have a Mary in different countries all across the world, and this one was the Mary for Brazil, and Aparecida means alike, similar, and so similar to Mary. So we were going to go to this huge Catholic pilgrimage. A million people were there throughout the week that Aparecida was there. So anyway, as we were waiting to go to Aparecida, we were distributing books, selling books. There's Brother Elvis on the streets of Lorena sharing with this fellow. And it was a really blessed experience. Nothing like call portering, getting the books out, and you see the reaction of people's faces as they light up and they desire truth. And we were able to share many books with the people. And here is the Basilica in, I forget the name of the town, it's a real long name.
Lorena.
No, it was outside of Lorena, the town, like started with a G. And Guarachita, Quita, something like that. But it was massive, and it was in the mountains. And if you see down here in the corner, I'm going to go over here, there's a woman walking on her knees all the way down the ramp as part of her pilgrimage. So there's a gentleman holding an umbrella over her head. So this woman is a serious Catholic, and she was committed to her cause. So it was a great large event, and I can show you these are in Revelation 18. It talks about the merchants of Babylon. Well, they had the whole area was filled with merchants, lots of merchants selling different things. You see the photos of Jesus up here and the heart, which is very much Catholic. And so it was a massive event. We were selling books, and it was interesting because we didn't sell many books, unfortunately, there, but I was selling them in Portuguese, and I sold two of them, and that was the most that even the we went with a couple, and they didn't sell any books, or they sold one book. I sold two, so I know it was divine help, because I was just there for a couple weeks at this time, and I was sharing in Portuguese, so it was a real blessing. This is another group. This is a group that we met in Anchieta, which is near Argentina, and they are a lovely people, and we spent some time. How many days? 10 days?
Two weeks?
10 days there. And this young man, his name is Talis, and he is right now in Mexico, and he is at a Gambetta's school in Mexico. And so we were trying to minister to this family regarding true education, and as well as what Trinitarianism really is and how we should be mindful of where we send our children to get an education. So these are the men, and then here are some of the women that we were with, the wives of the men, and so it was a real blessing to be there. This is another family out in the country that we visited, and Brother Elvis and I, and they want true education. There's a lot of the children there are seeking a better way. They don't get that in Brazil. They don't have the true education. It's very rare throughout the world, period, but there's a desire for these young people down here and here and here and here and here that they want to learn more of the ways of God. So the work was productive in planting seeds, but we need to continue the work there. And here, this brother, I think his name is Ronaldo. He was a real blessing. We had some Bible studies with him at night, and he was just a real, real bright fella, and had a lot of a desire to learn truth. He was friends with Zalia, and we share with him about the Father and the Son and the Trinity, and he was very receptive, very nice. And actually, we met him in the park of Lorena, in Lorena, just out of the blue. He was walking, we're like, hey, Ronaldo, and he came by. We spent 45 minutes, an hour just talking, and Brother Elvis was playing the flute, and we're just having a nice conversation with him. And then other people we know, two other girls came walking by, so it's kind of a small place, but it was a real blessing to be able to share and have that experience with these folks in Lorena. And this was in Cochia, where Brother Elvis had planted a seed in Cochia before he left, and I was actually helping build some homes. They were just getting out of the city. They were living in Cochia. This is outside of Cochia. Cochia is a suburb of Sao Paulo, similar to Chicago area. Oak Lawn would be a suburb of Chicago. Well, Cochia was a suburb of Sao Paulo, and so they were trying to get out of Cochia, and so they started building homes in the country. They have like four homes being built there. So I went out there for a couple Sundays, and we started with the foundation work. And then I was in another city called Capivari, which is outside of Sao Paulo as well, probably about an hour and a half. And we were actually helping to build a bathroom. It's a favela. A favela is a poor area, and they lived in whatever they can live in, and they didn't even have a bathroom. They would go to the bathroom in pipes and everything, and it was there was a great need there. So we were helping to build a bathroom, and this brother here is the one that lived there, and we were all helping. This is Gabriel, Gabriel, and so we were there building a bathroom, and it was a real good experience, very hot. And so we were there for a few days as well. And This is in another place, another area of Brazil called Marcos Azul. And this was towards the end of my trip. And this is the church building in Marcos Azul. Marcos Azul is maybe has 20 people that live there. And they have a little mark. Marcos Azul is, in Portuguese, is a blue mark. And they have a little blue stake that shows when you've arrived at Marcos Azul. And it's very, very small place. And we're like, when are we going to get there? And, oh, we just got here. I'm like, there's no size, you know, there's no size or anything. It's very much it's actually in the Amazon rainforest. It's not by the Amazon River, but this is near the Amazon rainforest. And they have a desire, and this is one of the locations that are interested in having a school there. And they have the church building, they have a Sabbath school building for the children already established. It's not a conference church. After they accepted the non-Trinitarian movement, the conference abandoned it for them. So they just left it. So there's this is inside the church where we're having some meetings and discussing different aspects of true education and as well as the Trinity and the non-Trinitarian message. So So it was a very nice experience up there. They don't have power. It's they run a generator, and so it's very nice. Here's a group in Sao Paulo. This is actually one of the contacts of the brethren up in Sorriso, where we went to Marcos Azul, put me in contact with this group. This group in Brazil, they have 900 people in the non-Trinitarian message on their mailing list for their newsletter. And so there's a great movement there in Brazil with many, many people who are receiving the truth. They're like Brother Elvis said, they're coming out of the conference churches, but they need a lot of education, a lot of instruction in who Jesus is, but also in the different reform. It's kind of in Portuguese they call it a bagunça, which is a mess down there. It's a mess. And so there's a lot of need down there for true education. And so, and that's the end of the slideshow, but I wanted to play a video, kind of a nice song from in Portuguese. I hope you'll be blessed by it. And just to, if you've never heard Portuguese before, it's a beautiful language, and I believe you'll receive a blessing. I think this is it. I don't know if the volume. Take the mic off. I wanted to just share a little bit of that with you. It's a beautiful language, and the people are beautiful as well. And just a little more of the testimony is, when I was in Sorriso and Sao Paulo, the Lord gave me utterance in a dark language. I didn't know it. I didn't know any language. And by the time I left, I was giving sermons in the language of Portuguese, which is a very, very difficult language. Many different verbs. So many verbs. They have 8 verbs for one word, and it's just you have to understand many tenses. And so I was really blessed. The Lord really gave me wisdom and understanding to be able to do it. And I'm kind of rusty, but I look forward, hopefully, to going back to Brazil and continuing the work there, and continuing learning the language and helping the people there. So that's what I want to share.
We thank God for all the blessings that we have been receiving during this week.
Amen.
Thank God for the Sabbath day, and thank God for all the brothers and sisters that I met during this camp meeting, and especially sister here. I don't remember your name, but I remember you from camp meetings ago, the first camp meetings that we had. I'm so glad to meet you again. And I give thanks for my family also, and especially for my wife, who also is making sacrifice for me to be here. And thank you for all my brothers and sisters who have been so kind, and I really appreciate your friendship and your hospitality. Tonight we're gonna finish our histology, anatomy, and physiology class on the brain. And I promise you that I will share something very important with you about the brain and how we can be perfect and reach the perfection of character, knowing how our body is function will help us a lot in attaining this perfection of character. We know that the three angel messages, the everlasting gospel, Revelation 14 verse 7, says, fear God and give him glory. How we can give glory to God? To reflect his character. And something very important, the three angel messages, the right hand of the three angel messages is what? The medical missionary work. You know, I have been giving massage to hundreds and thousands of people since I took my medical missionary training back in 1991 in California, Dr. Charles Thomas Place. And I believe David also was at that place one time. And, you know, I can imagine how I can give people massage with only my left hand. It would be very difficult, you know, to give someone treatment only with your left hand. And therefore, we can understand a little bit more how important it is that the everlasting gospel will go hand in hand with the medical missionary work. It's very important. And we see that people are suffering all over. We will be in Brazil, in Uruguay, in South America. And one of the big problems that we have today, many brothers and sisters of the church, tell me, I'm eating vegetarian. I quit smoking. I put away all kinds of sweet things, but still I'm not healthy. Still I'm suffering. What do you think it could be the problem?
Depression.
Mm-hmm.
Overwork.
Today, many people, our brothers and sisters also from the church, suffer from tension, stress, and depression. You know, I met a lot of brothers and sisters in South America who is being treated by psychologists because they have depression, using medication from psychiatry because of depression and stress and tension. And the book of Isaiah 58, if we study the whole chapter, God have given us a message, you know, to help people to be free from those things, from those disease and sickness. But something very important that I want to share tonight, about we talk about tension and stress, and especially when we use our muscles, the muscles of the face, we have to understand a little bit more scientifically what happens when muscles are under tension and stress, and people go into depression. I'm going to share some investigation, scientific investigation that have been made, and you will understand a little bit more about this. The demand of everyday life lead to stress, anxiety, and tension. The tension is manifest by an increase in muscle tightness. And therefore, we have to be sure that we are free from tension and stress, because stress and tension, if they continue or if they prolong, it will cause pathological damage. And I will continue sharing how important it is to relax. And this is not easy for many people who live today in this stressful world. And we will study a little bit what will happen when body is on tension and stress. It says unpleasant symptoms, whether they be pain, nausea, dizziness, shortness of breath, weakness, or also hyperventilation. Nervousness, anxiety, and tension tend to produce a condition called hyperventilation, overbreathing. The hyperventilation of the blood, as it courses through the lung, causes it to lose abnormal amount of carbon dioxide, and thus the blood becomes abnormal alkaline. The respiratory alkalosis causes further tension and may cause drop in blood pressure. And it says, consider cheerfulness, and when people are angry, consider the balance between the two parts of the autonomic nervous system. The sympathetic, which is stimulated by stress, anxiety, and tension, and the parasympathetic, which dominates during tranquility when the life forces and reserve are built up. And this is very important, that we be sure that we are not under tension, the muscles are not always under tension, under stress, and under depression. And I will share some more information that they made about this parasympathetic nervous system. It says on the study, they have come to understand that it leads the system to function in a proper way when the muscles are relaxed. Functions affected by the parasympathetic system, on the other hand, build up body reserves such as nutrition. This is a most wonderful design by the Creator. Then, when people are under stress, with muscles that are tight, it affects the whole body. Muscles, it affects also the nutrition of your body. And today we have great problem with stress, tension, and depression, and also our nutrition. Many people says we eat vegetarian and we still have some problem. But as we study a little bit more about agriculture, we see that most of the food that you can get today in the supermarket, when you eat them, you don't get your proper nutrition because of the lack of salt and mineral that is not there when the people raise up those fruits. And you know the business of the NGOs and all these things. And therefore, way back, Sister White tells us, out of the cities, look for a place where you can have
garden
that you can rip up your own fruits. And just before I came here to the United States, we harvest fruit down back on my farm. It's like it's a round fruit. It's like a little bit like berries, but it is full of juice. It has a big seed inside, and around that seed, when you put it in your mouth, it seems that you just taking juice, you know, and this fruit is full of vitamin C. And we sell them, and people buy them. And when we sell them, people call back and say, well, we want some more, because I saw a great difference with my health when we eat these fruits. And this is very important, that what we eat, our fruit, need to have all the vitamins that our body need. Otherwise, our muscles also will be weak. And that will affect the whole body. And as we study, the body and the mind have an intimate relationship. What we put in our body affects the mind, and what is in the mind affects the body. And how we can live in this time without stress, without to be depressed. We have to learn to relax. How we can relax in this time? How we can have a life of relax? How we can relax and how we can be free from stress and depression? It is just obeying the principles that God have given us. We know the new start, nutrition, exercise, water. You don't have to forget these principles, because it is very important for us to obey the Ten Commandments of the law of God. But it is also important for our health to obey the Ten Principles of Health. And we was working down in Brazil, and we are giving teaching about principles of health, and we have hard time telling people, you know, to dress properly. You know, there is quotation of Sister White that says that Satan is the one who invented
fashion.
Short. People are walking today almost naked. All these things affect our health. This is a dress reform that we have also to preach today, to help people to dress properly, because this is very important for circulation. Others have clothes that are too tight, that they cannot have proper breathing, that they cannot, the lungs cannot move, the abdomen cannot move in a proper way free, so that they can have good respiration. Another problem that we see today, that is a problem of correct posture. It's very important, correct posture, that we walk in the correct way, that we sit in the correct, that we sleep in the correct. Many people today, how do you sleep during the night, I say? Is that the proper, is that the correct posture to sleep?
No.
Some sleep on the side, others sleep on this side, others just sleep in that way. We have to relax. Before we go to sleep, we have to practice relaxation. Just relax and let go. And let all your muscles relax. And then pray and sleep. And you will see the difference in the morning when you wake up. We have to train ourselves to relax our muscles. Sometimes we just sit, but we are too tight sitting. We just have to relax so that our muscles can be more relaxing. And we have to cultivate also, you know, the habit of smile. When you smile, also your face will relax. And these are simple things, but we cannot imagine how good this is for the whole body. You know, and when we wake up in the morning, every morning, try to stretch your body and do muscle exercise. We have to do muscles exertion every day in fresh air, aerobic. Stretch the muscles, because we have around 636 muscles. And if we don't use them, and something very important, today many people say, I feel tired. I try to eat the best food that I can, but I still feel tired. It seems that at 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, you know, I'm not have power to continue. Something very important for us to understand. We get our nutrition, we get our vitamins, protein, and minerals from the food. But to be strong, the muscles to be strong, we need to exercise the muscles. You can eat good food, but if you don't exercise, then if you go into the cells, you will find the mitochondria, that these are the powerhouse of the cell. There we get up, then it is through exercise that we build up our strength. And therefore, it is important for us to study anatomy and physiology, and to understand better how our Creator have made this wonderful woman machine. And we're going to finish our study in Isaiah chapter 58. Isaiah chapter 58. God has given us a wonderful message, the three angel messages.
Amen.
Give God glory, fear Him and give Him glory. And we're going to read chapter 58. We're going to finish our study. It says, chapter 6, verse 6 of chapter 58 of Isaiah. Is not this the fast that I have chosen? To loose the bands of wickedness, to undo the heavy burdens, and to let the oppressed go free, and that ye break every yoke. Hey, brothers and sisters, we have to let go of anxiety. We have to let go of all bad habits. We have to let go of guilt. We have to let go of every single thing that can affect the mind and the body. And if we let these things go, let loose, verse 11, and the Lord shall guide thee continually, and satisfy thy soul in drought, and make fat thy bones. And thou shalt like be a watered garden, and like a spring of water, whose water fail not.
In a few seconds, Brother Elvis, can you teach us how to teach someone else how to stand correctly, how a bad posture and a good posture?
Okay. Still have some minutes, but Pastor Stump? Okay. When we stand, we have to stand in the proper way that we can breathe properly. Our shoulders, we have to be in symmetry. If you look me on the side, you have to see a line from my ear going down, go straight to the shoulder and going down. Then we have to have the habit that stands straight. And when we walk, we have to walk straight and also keep our chest so that we can breathe properly. Many people have the habit to, and when you are stressed, most of the time you work like this, with burdens on your, if it is not a physiological problem that you have. with your bones or things, but we have to be sure that we walk properly and breathe when we walk. And when we sit down, we also have to sit in a proper way that we have the chair. Many people used to sit like this. We have to sit properly and have correct posture. And this is very important for us because this will help us to be in symmetry and have to help every bones and every muscles to function properly. And also, you know, many people, many person, those who have money, you see them all the time with a big wallet, you know, on this side, big wallet, and then they sit. And when they sit all the time, you know, their pelvic will be like this. And after that, people will be walking on one side or on the other side. These are simple things, but if you do it all the time, it will affect the body.
Cords on the floor.
So, and also very, some counsels, when you sleep, also try to sleep on your back all the time. Just relax and sleep on your back. Not on your face and not on your side, but sleep on your back so that all your organs can be free of stress and they can function properly.
Best not to sleep with a pillow?
That's a very important question. The best way to sleep is to sleep flat without pillows. Some people can do that, but the best way is to sleep without pillows. Some people use two or three pillows, and then you will see that your body will be not in the proper posture. And then you will sleep. Your body is there, and then your head is just maybe 45 degrees, and that's not a correct posture. You have to sleep, try to sleep in the good posture. Okay. So, if there is no other questions, we will close our message for tonight.
Modesty.
Oh. Yeah, modesty.
Spiritual and physical.
Mm-hmm. Yes, modesty or temperance and all will help us to have the perfection of character. Modesty and everything, and especially the way we use everything. Food, the way we dress, the way we speak, everything have to do in a proper way and be temperance in everything. This is very important. I'd like to share one quotation before I finish with you. And this will be encouragement for each one of us that have been here studying the perfection of character. And this you will find it in First Selected Messages, page 2:11 and 2:1-2. It says, through the measure of his grace, furnished to the human agent, not one need miss heaven. Is that in Corson's quotation? Perfecting of character is attainable by everyone who strive for it. This is made the very foundation of the new government of the gospel. The law of Jehovah is the tree, the gospel is a fragrant blossom and fruit which it bears. May God bless us and strengthen us, and that we can reflect the character of Jesus Christ in our life.